Microlecture 15, the Asian Maritime Sphere. Maritime trade was important in Asia during the early modern period. Since 1400, trade routes connect China, Korea, and Japan. In the 16th century, Portuguese, Spanish, Dutch, and English, eager for products such as porcelain, spices, and silk, began to participate in the East Asian maritime world. Christian missionaries follow these trade routes. The trade between Japan, China, Korea, and Southeast Asia was very profitable, and the Europeans logically wanted a piece of it. The Portuguese and the Dutch were not reluctant to use force to gain control of trade, and they took over many outposts along the trade routes. Perhaps the most important of all was Taiwan. The Europeans also made little distinction between trade, smuggling, and piracy. In the late 16th century, the Chinese agreed to give the Portuguese a piece of land to build a trading post. They wanted to prevent European violence. The city the Portuguese built was Macau, which remained in their hands until 1999. For centuries, Macau was the first destination of all Europeans who wanted to visit China. European products were not in demand in China, but silver was. Usually, silver came from Japan, but with the conquest and colonization of the Americas, there was a new source, and European traders began to supply the Chinese market. This commerce allowed the expansion of the Chinese economy and made the Europeans rich. Chinese were quick to take advantage of the new trading ports set up by the European powers. Manila under Spanish control and Taiwan and Batavia, present-day Jakarta, both under Dutch control, attract thousands of Chinese colonists. Besides silver, American crops like sweet potato, maize, peanuts, tomatoes, chili peppers, tobacco were quickly adopted in East Asia. The Spanish and Portuguese crowns support missionary activity, and merchant vessels soon brought Catholic missionaries to East Asia. By the year 1600, there were 300,000 baptized Christians in Japan. Most of them lived in Kyushu, where the shogun's power was weakest and the daimyo loyalty most doubtful. The Tokugawa shogunate believed that Christianity was associated with domestic disorder and insurrection, and in 1639 stepped up its repression of the religion. Foreign priests were expelled and thousands of Japanese Christians were crucified. In China, the Jesuits invested themselves in learning the language. They established a relationship with members of the educated class. The missionary Matteo Ricci traveled for years around the area and interest educated Chinese men in Western geography, astronomy, and Euclidean mathematics. The Jesuits believed that Confucianism and Christianity shared things like their concern for moral virtue and worship forms. In China and Japan, many aspects of Western culture were seen as impressive and worth learning. European medicine, astronomy, and the arts were admired and, in some cases, accepted as superior. The admiration was not one-sided, since the Europeans also saw Asian advancements as something impressive, and many things from the area enjoyed a positive reputation. For example, Voltaire wrote about rationalism and Confucianism and saw advantages in the Chinese political system. The East Asian maritime world underwent many changes from the 16th to the 18th centuries. The Japanese closed down and limited opportunities for Europeans to trade in Japan. In China, the Qing government limited trading contacts with Europe to Guangzhou in the far south in an attempt to curb piracy. Portugal lost many of its bases to the Dutch, and by the 18th century, the British had become as active as the Dutch. In the 17th century, the British and the Dutch wanted porcelain and silk, but tea became the commodity in most demand in the 18th century. The Europeans' eruption in the East Asian maritime space was decisive for the future of the area and world commerce. The impact of the imperialist attitudes of the Europeans had long-term consequences and transformed the culture and economy of these territories. This is all I have for you today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.